zillion off the board, as we've been seeing quite a bit of the Time Lord recently.
Yeah, exactly. And Cloud9, they actually, like we said, have control of their own destiny. If they 2-0 Fox here today, they actually lock Liquid into fifth place, regardless of what the result is tomorrow or what CLG ends up doing, because CLG is 2-0 over Team Liquid, and they could upset that team. Also, Cloud9, if they don't drop games from here on out, they will be your third place team.
I'm sure that's exactly what they have on the top of the docket, getting ready to check off. Sivir, Ashe, I've been wondering when both of these AD carries are actually going to find themselves on the ban list. Usually it's the Sivir as a last ban for a team, and the Ashe will fall somewhere in the comp. Not this time. It's going to bring it down to the Jhin and something else, maybe an Ezreal, as well as that Vladimir getting banned out.
Yeah, expect that Malzahar to come through as well. 91% prevalence for that champion. And also, if Cloud9 take it, you have to wonder, is your Zillion up to date? And if you take it, Jensen's the one who was busting out the Zillion versus Malzahar and said it's a great, comfortable champion.
Also, junglers, top laners, loving this pick and ban phase as they come through completely clean.
Yeah, it's going to be Rek'Sai first, I assume, from Meteos here. And then that's going to leave hard for maybe the Gragas that he's been favoring. Hecarim has been coming back a bit as well.
Yeah. See, hard not scared to go in, likes to play the Elise, propelling through a fight, rush in with a horse, either or. He knows what to do on the back line, so that fits him quite well. Seeing a jungler, however, they don't have to pick that right away. We'll see if it's the AD carry that wants priority here.
Probably not going to pick two AD carries. I assume that they go with a Jhin to take it away from Sneaky.
Yep.
Also, it's kind of risky to pick your Jhin early on, but it is really that utility AD carry that's left when Sivir and Ashe are both taken off of the table, so you may see a champion like that come through early on.
I think it does fit Keith. Obviously, these guys have all continued to play the champions as they are released. He's always that Tristana player we used to remember as well. In the back line, being a huge carry for the team. We'll see if he can start off fights with that curtain call now on the Jhin. Also, the Karma being picked up.
Yeah, take it away from Sneaky. Very proficient on that champion. Two AD carry bans. You see that come through. So the Jhin is that last utility one left in that trinity of those top tier AD carries. And then the Karma flex pick as well. We have seen some teams run it in the mid lane to mixed effect, but definitely think it'll enable a lot more of the team as they go down. If you do pick up a Hecarim, it's great alongside that champion, and it allows you to play things in the mid lane maybe a little less mobile, like Cassiopeia for Froggen.
Yeah, both mobile champions have really been taken out here. The Zillion and the Sivir probably won't be seen too much throughout the entire set of these three games if we see it. Cloud9 hoping to make it too. And it's going to be Shen and the Tempered Fate from Bard picked up. So they actually give themselves a for sure engage if they want it here on the side of Cloud9.
Yeah, and Smoothie's Bard has actually been quite good.
Yeah.
And this makes you think about that Cassiopeia pick if you want to take it for Froggen, because you're easy to catch out. And if you take it this early as well, you do risk getting counterpicked. So I assume they leave Froggen for last pick here. They pick their top laner, and then they think about it just a little bit more and get a better lay of the land. Because if you pick the Cassiopeia, you can pick Taliyah into it. And Jensen has shown that he is willing to play that champion.
That's true. Something we see banned against TSM and Cloud9 quite frequently is that Taliyah. It's gone all the way through with four mid lane bans still on the board. Shen and Rek'Sai give Cloud9 such global presence already. Being able to hover the other side of the map, Void Rush back, and a stand united means KFO and the rest of the team are going to have to really think about their teleport plays and where they even engage on the map with a group of people. Looks like it could be Gragas locked in. Not sure about the Gangplank, though. It will actually be locked in.
Yeah, I actually like both these picks with the Rek'Sai being taken away. Hard next down the tier list for him will be the Gragas. Mm-hmm. Not so much those aggressive junglers like the Hecarim, but it does give them a front line. It allows them to pick a damage-dealing top laner, and that's the Gangplank. The Gangplank up against the Shen matchup, it's really brutal for Shen. He can't really do anything during the early game. There may be a lane swap coming out here from Cloud9 because Gangplank gets a free farm lane. He actually gets to harass you as well. And then later on, he does have the armor penetration on his barrels that make it really hard for Shen to still survive despite being so tanky.
And that's what we got to keep an eye on is later on, right? Echo Fox loves to play the later on game. Look at the guy in the mid lane. It is Froggen. We'll see what he chooses to charge up on this one. We did just see some Xerath play. Froggen's been known to do that, so we may actually round out the composition if that Karma is not his. Seeing on the side of Cloud9 as they get their last two picks, as we see the AD carries further and further down the list. It is Ezreal for Sneaky and that Cassiopeia for Jensen.
And we'll see what ends up going over to Froggen here. You would want something like a Victor, have that wave clear, and yeah, that's what it's going to be.
I don't even have to think about it. Just give me the Victor. Lock it in. Also, something he can really change the tide of a fight with, a nice Chaos Storm, a good laser placement, and Froggen can really help to carry this team. KFO, however, is also bringing DPS from the top lane, and Big can bring that with Karma in the bottom. So there is actually a lot of power on this side of Fox, but can they keep up with this global pressure of the Cloud9 squad?
Yeah, and Cloud9 has a lot of in-combat CC that you have to pay attention to and have to be weary of, because this Cassiopeia will get to a point where she can stand there, and then if your damage isn't high enough, it's a damage check, and she can stand there, use her Seraph's Embrace, she'll end up having your backline temper faded, and then she might even get a Shen Shield on top of it. So yeah, you have to be very careful of how far ahead Jensen gets in this game, if he does. But we've seen Cloud9 struggle and falter when you camp Jensen, and that should be what Fox are looking for this game.
Coaches leaving off on game one. We're seeing pretty regular compositions in what will be the strategies coming out of both teams. So nothing new here as we enter into our games in week nine, at least from these two. We've opened up the polls on Twitter, so contribute your vote using the hashtag C9win or the hashtag FOXwin to call the winner of this series. Remember, it definitely helps C9 to get the 2-0 here as they move towards that playoff spot.
Yep, and it'll definitely help them keep control of their own destiny.
Yeah.
As they have to play Liquid tomorrow. If they 2-0 that, they end up in that third place 100%. Keep that alive. And don't allow CLG to leapfrog them.
All right, so we are onto the Rift. Ocean Drake will be first, as everybody will wander around that. Like you said, C9 maybe not wanting to get that matched up lane on this. We'll see if they do decide to swap it. KFO would easily be able to just farm up if they were able to go 1v1.
Yeah, that's the worry, but at the same time, if you don't swap it, you do have a very good early ganking jungler, and that would allow Meteos to play towards Impact, which we've seen him do more and more lately. Remember their last set that they played last week, where he was camping top, he shut down, I believe it was Seraph, and allowed Impact just to roll over those matchups. It doesn't look like anybody's going to go for those lane swap wards, though, and it's probably going to be a standard start here. For Meteos, it'll most likely be a Gromp over to his red side jungle and skip his blue buff. Gromp Wolves Raptors. Gromp Raptors Red. Okay. He's just petting his tail. It's a good Rek'Sai.
Friendly dancing.
Belong in a museum.
Well, that's not nice.
It's a different relationship down here.
Well, everybody is friendly today. I'm ready to go. Is it? It's not Storm Raiders. I was wondering if Froggen would take that. He goes Thunder Lord in the mid lane. We've seen it swap back and forth every so often, depending on if you really just want to crush your lane out as soon as you get that ult. And it looks like we actually will get the matched up lane, so we'll have to see what the junglers can provide in this situation, but as well, if KFO can get a good start and actually be a huge carry for the team, is like to put it to Froggen, I should say.
Yeah, and Froggen has been very consistent in his games. He's always had pretty much the highest damage every time. Yeah, just punishing smoothly, but Keith, the damage on your AD carry is definitely a lot more worth, unless you end up going for like a flash and trying to get that crit shot onto Smoothie.
And there's bits of sustain for Smoothie once they start leveling in those little relics, so they can absorb this a little bit. But as well, you can see how frantically they're trying to thread in those autos, thread in the attacks, has to get the last hit, misses the Q, because you're still trying to get the CS when you get it in here. I love when lanes happen.
This may be a bottom lane visit from Meteos. He went from Gromp to Wolves to Red, standard Rek'Sai route to gank bottom. If they're trading heavily, you always want to trade before your jungler comes in, because he's coming in at full HP. If they're coming in at like 3/4, they're going to get killed. Meteos looking for exactly that play.
Hard looking for that in the mid lane as well. Which one is going to work first? The flash in, they're looking at Big on the right. Focus is on Keith on the left, though, and they don't have enough damage. Jensen just has to walk himself down. Does use his ghost to get out of that situation.
Yeah, and Sneaky actually gets chunked out simultaneously. Yeah. So overall, C9 avoiding a gank in the mid lane because of the pressure from Hard, and Hard's going to actually walk around. find a ward for himself and look for a repeat gank here, but he is spotted out by Medios.
Jensen Jensen doesn't even want to play with this because Hard is ready to activate the initiation. So now Medios can say flash down. They have the 5-minute mark on that as well for Hard too.
Exactly. This is actually a better trade of summoner spells though for Fox, in my opinion, because the jungler flashes down, your mid laner, both mobility summoners.
Yep.
So Froggen had to blow one, and then you blew your junglers, but then the bottom lane didn't actually have to use a summoner at all except for that heal. That's the only one that they had to use. No flashes, so Medios' time in the bottom side, maybe not as effective as he would have wanted it to be, but still, your Ezreal gets it back on a tier timing, which is exactly what you want for your bottom lane.
A bit ahead in that CS.
KFO's in trouble, like in big trouble.
He's staying for the fight, feeling like the W could really give him the upper hand. The minion wave is in his favor, but he doesn't have enough time to even auto. And Impact says, thanks for the minion wave.
That's usually a miserable matchup as well for the Shen. That's huge. If Impact is able to win that by himself, that just means that KFO, you know, he's got some work to do here. He's going to go back to the lane. I feel like he could have waited as well for full HP, but... teach their own.
I was actually just going to mention that. I think it was a thing of KFO saying, I have a W to heal, so I'll get low. But at a certain point, that heal only brings you up so much. Mm-hmm. So you're still in a really tough spot. And he just let himself get too low, disregarding Impact's power in front of the turret. And coming back with low health probably won't bite him in the butt. He'll regen back up here. But yeah, playing much safer now.
He's got to be super careful, though.
Yeah.
Because why does the enemy Shen stick around when he's alone? With that HP, you have to be a little bit cautious of it.
Smoothie, stepping up front, making sure the minions are easy in the method and madness to hitting under a turret. Hard picks up blue, but doesn't look like they're really giving too much more pressure towards mid, actually, on those summoners. Just warding to make sure Froggen doesn't get any ganks on himself. Big to the mid lane is pushed off as well. So while Cloud9 is protecting Jensen, looks like Fox is setting up the wards to maybe go back in.
And KFO setting up as well. No TP for Impact. Used it to get back to lane to shove his wave out even harder.
Good CS lead. We'll have a level lead, which may allow him to stand united across the map before they regard it, or before they think that teleport is back up.
Yeah, also the fact that Gangplank usually has an answer in the cannon barrage.
That's true.
But he won't have that available if it's a level 6 right on time. Stand united.
So neither of those guys can really give each other too much trouble at the turret, but that is the 6 for Impact. That window must be called now by KFO in the top lane, so Fox does not go outside their boundaries in an engage, but every lane right now for C9 is pushed up. Medios is able to farm and have a field day, and Hard is looking to make one of these lanes get pushed back or get something back.
Yeah, Hard's being very active. I'll give him that. It's been a rough split for Fox, and a lot of it has been the junglers figuring out what they need to do at what times in the game. And he's been good at monitoring the vision. He's been constantly smiting the Raptors and countering Medios when he sees him on the map.
Oh, he hits the barrel. Nicely done. Also counting as well KFO's barrels at this level and how many he's going to be using. Really keeping tabs on that to win the matchup.
Yeah, KFO, he actually has his work cut out for him against Impact. Impact seems to have played this matchup a lot.
Yeah.
And knowing the priorities there, hitting the barrel more than hitting that Gangplank, even if you get the pull through with the Q, you really want to swing at him with that percent HP damage. But nope, ends up going for the actual just auto on the barrel and is well placed.
See if Medios can make a difference. The knockup.
There's no flash for KFO either. He had to blow it earlier in 1v1, which might be his undoing because Jensen's coming up with Ghost.
Ooh, so if they show Jensen late
and
hit
taunt
Medios
flash
first, he gets the orange out of Medios and this. There it is. Now the crowd control can stick. And they are on KFO one after the other and systematically take him down as Fox tries to activate something in the bot lane.
And that's all because Impact got the 1v1 flash out of KFO and they punished it. Now he doesn't have TP to get back to lane. It's an even bigger advantage for this top laner who can spill it over so easily into other lanes with the Stand United.
This composition looks scary when C9 was drafting it.
Yeah.
There's so many possibilities at every point of the game, but you're also stacking tiers at the same time, so it's super dangerous. Especially when you get a bit of a lead, it makes it work even better. Fox is gonna try to answer back now, knowing C9's taking a breather. spending some of that cash money. Fox is going to go ahead and pick up Ocean Drake. Definitely help out hard. Frog and stay in the lanes a little bit longer if we're getting pushed out.
Yeah, KFO definitely needs it as well. He's taking a lot of harass.
That's a good point.
Shen is winning the matchups based off of that mostly. He's getting these trades where Shen will lose the matchup if he's not aggressive and he's passive. Oh, smoothie. Almost dead. Oh!
So smoothie. Stand United.
Just what the doctor ordered for him.
Whew. Very close.
Gets out with the help of Impact. So Impact's going to have to walk his way back up to that top side. Gives KFO some time, but I don't think he's going to miss any creeps.
Right. And those kind of things are super annoying as well if they continue to happen. So there's a point in a game when that happens three times. The fourth time, maybe you will go for the guy because you want the kill because it's happened so many times. Those kind of things can really sway your mind in the way you take to a situation. Hopefully for Fox, they can solidify those next kills so they don't fall into that pit. See, it's only one for now, 9 minutes in. However, Cloud9 is working the map very well, and if they can start getting this vision in, they'll shut down Fox even more.
Meteos hanging around that red buff.
Mm-hmm.
Quite ahead of Hard at the moment. I want to say he's about a full level up. Yeah, he's a full level up. Full bar. And he still has his flash available. Hard used his twice now for failed ganks, ones that did not result in any kills. And he's not going for those Ionian Boots of Lucidity first build. He's going for that Tracker's Knife, trying to ward up Meteos' jungle. Because Meteos went for the Sight Stone. Don't want to have that disadvantage.
Oh, how much is it worth? How much is it worth, Hard? Almost goes down. He'll be fine. He's good.
Just barely. 26 HP there. Getting out by the skin of his teeth. Does get a summoner spell for it, but...
Yeah.
Now he's off the map. He has no presence, and you can see KFO has to back up because they don't know where Meteos is. And Meteos actually gets the flash out of Froggen in the mid lane.
All right, so fight in top and in bottom. Teleports are up, as well as Void Rush for Meteos to make it anywhere he wants. Sneak is going to have to take damage here. And they turn that one quickly around. A nice tempered fake because that may have been someone's death.
Nicely played there.
Mm-hmm.
Ends up.
Ooh.
Still reducing the cooldown of the curtain call because it counts as being canceled.
Good to know.
But still. It means he doesn't have to dodge around or anybody take any extra damage. It's a big counter to Jhin.
Ooh.
That and Ashby can hit him with an arrow, but this is much easier.
I think something's going to happen.
Yeah, it's probably going to be five people in the bot lane.
Wards, however. Wards are your friend. It may stop Fox from really getting anything out of this. Not sure that they know. Jensen's just over the wall. Again, Hard puts himself really deep, and this time they get away with a bit more HP so they can fight another day.
Yeah, it looked like it would have been a good situation for Fox because Smoothie was just so low. He didn't have his Tempered Fate available. You may have been able to pull something out there, even with just an ultimate from KFO. But now they're just going to try to get priority on the bottom side. Hard spotted out in the jungle, but he's still just kind of cruising around. He's doing this a lot. What do I do?
Waiting to see Cam's back up. Obviously saw the Raptor blip. And then he can walk down there and realize he was on a ward. Oh. Usually you see it the other way around. When Gangplank hits the barrel, your HP disappears.
Yeah.
Not Gangplank's. Good lord.
They have to be careful because Hard will take this fight on the bottom side.
Word. Look at the wards on the bottom side here for Fox. They pretty much know they can just keep going. Arcane shift over. Sneaky back to the other side. Every summoner's been used. The Shrine on Sneaky from Smoothie as well. And they are holding each other dearly behind the turret as they take down Hard.
And Smoothie ends up blocking the deadly flourish on top of it. It's an actual just linear skill shot. It hits the first person.
Right.
It does not hit multiple people.
Still trying to go for it. Keith's low on mana here. Doesn't mean he can't auto-attack, and they still look like they want a little bit more, but Cloud9 pulls up. We'll see it again.
Absolutely crazy. Sneaky's the target. One hits, two hits, saves it.
Oh.
Gets the E off, flashes the opposite side, is on the other side, takes the Thunderlords, and would have died to the W, but Smoothie right on top of it. Absolutely insane that he lives through that.
Those are those things, Dairene. You almost get a kill, but it doesn't come through.
What Tilt is made of.
Every time. KFO now. Looks like he's going to get a bite from the Queen, and Meteos will make that happen. Nice shot under the turret as he steps off to the side.
Yeah, still looked like he was having some fun there. Doesn't give an assist over to Impact and wastes a little bit of Jensen's time. This turret takes some damage. But now Cloud9 are just eking out advantages here and here. It's almost 2,000. Really early on in this game, they're just getting these three kills just mostly off of the back of Impact.
Right, the play, the global presence we talked about, the Rek'Sai, the Shen already. Meteos can void rush down. Impact there with a stand united. And Fox, they had the wards for that play. They had everything. They had the vision to go down there. And you don't expect people to get away with a combined 200 HP between two people.
Yeah, and I even give him some credit for that last kill that went on to KFO, because he was zoning him from actually retreating to his own turret.
Right.
From a very awkward angle where you don't expect him to come from.
Relentless. That's kinda awkward too. Fox is relentless. Hard over the wall, says I'll dodge something, but I found a mobile vision ward and Meteos.
You really need to activate Froggen. Froggen is just zoning or roaming as much as he can.
Yeah. Got a CS lead in that.
Yeah, he's got a CS lead. He's at 10 per minute, so he's doing a really good job. He has his upgrade all the way up, so he's already at that point where it's going to chase you down. The Chaos Storm is incredibly fast. People are still on boots one. Cassiopeia, no boots ever.
There's going to be a Cloud Drake next. That's still quite warded up here by Fox. They've almost kind of said, KFO, you got to do your own thing in the top lane. We are going to start focusing bottom.
Yeah, it's a little strange that they sack that lane. I expect them to play more towards the middle side of the map. The bottom lane, it is actually okay to play to that one too, but I still feel as though mid-bot with that type of focus and allowing KFO to salvage the situation is the best plan of action, but I mean, it went rough for him. Usually that's a good matchup.
Right, and it's the thing we kind of came into the match saying is, do Fox double down on Froggen, or do they find that new strategy and new way to kind of get themselves through a mid-game slump? Here, they're trading Dragons now for Herald. This will make Impact even bigger, so that's going to be tough for KFO in that sense.
Yeah, and if he can get it, probably no steal from a Cannon Barrage or anything, so we'll go over to Impact. And that's just going to be a nail in the coffin there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe not the final one for KFO, but it's definitely another nail.
They're still waiting for a big fight. Cloud9 has been able to find these kind of counterattack kills one after the other. Impact did have his solo in the top. But where's the 5v5? Fox still charging up, as well as Cloud9. Probably get a pretty volatile fight when it comes to. Might see our first turrets go down, but as I say that, Cannon Barrage stops it right in its tracks.
Exactly. That's actually really good. He puts that Cannon Barrage on the bottom, clears the wave, delays, because now they're doing a delayed lane swap where your AD carry got an advantage bottom by getting that turret, put him up against the next structure in line, go to that top side.
Fox looking for turret number two now. C9 backing off of this. So Fox, maybe no kills, but they're able to clean up the gold around the map. This outer ring of turrets is going to be their funding for now. We'll see what they can do with it.
I think you keep pushing here as well.
Mm-hmm. Looking at that push to the bot lane, sneaky.
All the way to the turret. Go to where Impact is. Make sure he doesn't have this crazy Stan United play available to him. And nope, they're just going to back off. They have no idea where Meteos is. He could be behind them. Because those pink wards and that control that Cloud9 have of their topside jungle, it ends up with just a small push.
And I feel like when something happens good, like as Fox moves here, Cloud9 is already saying, all right, they move top. They push that. And in the next few minutes, Cloud9 may have mid this second tier and something else.
Yeah, this is actually really interesting because Froggen, he roams down to the bottom side of the map to pick up this wave. And I actually don't see this enough from teams where the mid laner is willing to shove up mid and then run to a lane that's being pushed in. Because he may have been able to do that move right there on the bottom tier one and maybe save it. But it is a very risky move because he can get three-man dove at that point. If he was the team that had the Shen, then it's definitely a good move.
We'll see if that comes through and picks next time. KFO on too much Shen. But after seeing what Impact's doing, you can say, I can do damage on that guy. We'll make it happen.
Can he, though?
Can he? We'll see. Wards all along that top side show you what Fox had had in mind, I should say. They've gotten that turret. Now they're looking for the mid lane to open it up. Fox hard has not been in that bottom side of the jungle. for quite some time now. Seems like they kind of gave up on that since the turret had gone down. They got what they wanted out of it. It's all about that fight, though. I'm still waiting to see this 5v5. A bit of that golden gap has been closed by Fox here.
Yeah, they got a turret up, and it was not answered by Cloud9, because they got that bottom turret for free, and then Fox initiated a lane swap to try and just get everybody a little bit of a boost in gold in the game, get them closer to those power spikes. Well, looks like they may want to cut off impact, but I feel like that's just really ambitious, so just going to get control of the jungle.
Mm-hmm.
And lose their top turret! This is the advantage that they have, and it's probably going to be gone now. They have to dive mid, they have to do something here, but it's the Shen. The Shen could stop the Cassiopeia from actually going down. And Fox, it's kind of like the whole chicken with their head cut off thing right now. Like, they're losing their top turret and they aren't getting anything. That was what they had going for them. And that's not even just a standard, like, oh, now we're like continuing the lane swap. That's, we could have put our AD carry back in the top side and answered and defended this turret. They're going for the greedy tier two here. And that's the plan, that's the play.
Oh, Impact isn't even taking that much damage. Gonna be one for one in the top, one for three in the bot, and everybody pretty much misses Impact. He gets some time to dance around now, and the crowd control leaves him standing. Mid's gonna be pushed here by Jensen, and Fox has to again scramble back to something that didn't work. Trying to put resources in the bot lane has fizzled out.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Fizzles out, and now it's at 1-on-1 in the top side, and Sneaky's been able to just get free farm for a bit. He also got solo turret gold earlier. Spills some gold into KFO, but overall, now that the turret was even back up, you can see that gold advantage goes back to where it was.
Here's the roam from Jensen. Looks like he's warding up.
Stealing
Raptors.
He can't let Froggen get too far ahead of him. Just every CS, you know, just take the little ones, pad your CS. You know, I'm a 300. 100 of those might be little Raptors, but it doesn't matter. Game counts.
True. C9 taking their time to back. Were the advantages, 2K being spent there onto Jensen. Gets himself built up. And there's about 1,000 gold in the top three members of Fox, KFO Hard and Froggen. So they're still kind of waiting. This team always likes to bring it to that late game and see where they can get their mechanics in the fight, if that's where they can grab an advantage.
Yeah, I feel as though Froggen is waiting for that Rylai's Crystal Scepter buy, but looks like he'll back now. Probably pick up the Giant's Belt. Get one step closer to completing that item. Oh, or he actually had the gold for it. Okay, so more than 1,000 was available for him.
Pretty nice Muramana finish as well for Sneaky.
Yeah, actually 20 minutes. 21 minutes. Rather quick for him. He got that solo turret gold. So he was able to get the item right quick. Sports his Iceborne. Oh my god, KFO. KFO! Knocked
out. So well played. Not even a miss. Not a stopped auto attack, just very clean play on the Shen.
That feels awful. Wow. Impact. 3 kills now. Rift Herald buff on top of it. Like, I swear this matchup, it doesn't favor Shen that much. Because every time you taunt, he's going to orange out of it. And then he's able to harass you down, use barrels and the like. But this is just a matchup that KFO is getting outplayed in.
The Ghost. Chases him in, Stand United as well. They have so many things to prevent the initiations or even the pickoff from Fox.
Yep.
They would give them a little bit of an opening.
Echo Fox, I feel like they wanted that second Cloud Drake really badly because their rotations are always just a little bit late. You can see like Froggen, he's been roaming. Even with the one Cloud Drake, he roams to the side lane and then he kind of calls it off because it's like, ah, oh, maybe I'm not there in time or maybe we're not actually engaging in time or the wave in mid is getting pushed too fast. It's like if he's there just a little bit faster, you get to pull the trigger on that play. And it's all relative too, so he'd be much faster than his opponents in that rotation.
No matter what, Sneaky to the side lane. Cloud9 always have it. He does have a global ult. It may not be the Ash Arrow. Jensen with a very nice directional flash to safety there. Once he was forced into the fight by the displacement of Hard. And it looks like the team will gather for this. Sneaky is going to slightly push, but also back and forth to go into that mid lane.
That's going to be KFO going back down to the bottom side to catch the wave eventually. And they got the summoner spells out of Jensen, but Froggen didn't have ulti, so It was mostly to get that summoner spell out and trade yours as a jungler for the mid laners. And I feel like Hard did that at the start of the game, and then he didn't revisit the lane.
That happens quite a few times. It always brings me back to hearing Prolly say to H2K during a playoff reel before he went to playoffs is, if you blow a flash, you go back to that lane.
Yes.
You do not let 5 minutes go to waste.
Exactly.
You do something to that lane, and a lot of times you see it fizzle out.
Yeah, a lot of times, even in like solo queue or something like that, you gank a lane, you get the flash, and then you're like, all right, you're on your own, brother.
Yeah.
Hopefully you could kill him. And then you're like, hey, I blew his flash 5 minutes ago. Why wasn't he dead?
Come
it's
back.
Like, it's like, you have to come back for that.
Yeah.
You have to really make his life a living hell, mm-hmm. and they don't do that.
And that's exactly what pretty much KFO got this game.
You can't be nice. You have to be really mean in League of Legends as a jungler. Like, how many times have you been camped and
are you
just complaining?
Are you advocating being toxic?
No, I'm saying that, you know, you test other people for their toxicity by camping them.
So what you're saying is no mercy.
Just tilt them.
Just tilt them. We will see. You are the king of salt. I will listen.
I am the sultan.
The sultan. 2K gold lead now for Cloud9 as they have kind of not hit a wall, but are taking their time. I'm sure they have an in on a few of these fights, but they don't want to give Fox a chance to actually get one of the kills. It's 4-0 for a reason, and because Cloud9 is playing very safe in their attacks.
Yeah, and it's seriously, three of those deaths are KFO, three of those kills are being picked up on impact. Like,
this is true.
You can't fight him right now if you're KFO. I don't know if anybody on Fox can actually fight him. You'd pretty much have to wave clear against him. And even then, you can't send your Victor to do that because it's double global from this Shen. He'll be able to pull off a move that helps his team, whereas the Victor would have to just roam every single time a play might happen, and he would still be late.
Resources getting picked up. I feel like Cloud9 may be approaching a point where they could bait out one of these objectives. Start picking off Fox one by one.
Ooh, I actually like this. Meteos goes for the Ruby Sightstone as a jungler. So very early buy there. It actually has a lot of HP. It's 500 now. And the activatable part, people don't even care about it that much. It was reduced in cost, so it just became more stat efficient in the first place. Also allows them to carry four wards. So tons of vision here.
Well, for Smoothie, you see that more on supports, but...
Yeah. I was very surprised when it first changed over, nobody in Europe was really doing it. NA, there was like one or two people, and it was only melee supports that were doing it. And now it's definitely increased in popularity.
Rubies everywhere. Eric's happy.
Oh boy, he hit Keith already. Impact looking for the taunt.
Oh, Meteos actually got pulled back by the gravitational field there, and he could not get the pop-up he wanted. But look at how Cloud9 is kind of lining themselves up. They get into the river knowing that fighting in the Tri-Bust was a terrible position. They put themselves in a much better area, and a much better dodging area as well for that curtain call.
Yeah, it cancels the last few shots on that. And just back to dancing around that Baron.
All right. Cloud against the Scuttle.
They end up getting the stuff grabbed. Oh, flat knockup!
Meteos hits it in hard to Jensen and Smoothie on the back line. They try to spread and out the spread, and the focus is onto Hard as
they
he gets taunted down. Sneaky's on the outside. He's actually holding four off because he can slow them with the gauntlet, and they know they can't get through. Hard is a loss in that fight, and they have to start backing up to defend mid.
But yeah, Hard just went in way too far, and it looked like he was trying to get his team to help him. No cannon barrage from KFO, and Hard doesn't flash out when the play starts going south. He ends up in a 4-on-1. So, definitely not ideal.
Retreating down for Cloud9 there was much easier than Fox trying to retreat up or back into
Well, Fox wanted them to follow them up into the left.
Right.
Choke points for Victor. Because, like, Froggen didn't even use ultimate, none of those things.
Exactly.
Because this is a team that wants to fight you in chokes. You want to be able to section people off. Because Gragas Barrels even work better in choke points with the explosive cast. Because half of them are going to go to the front, half of them are going to go back. Left or right really doesn't matter too much. In open area, it does.
And Meteos takes advantage of the funnel as well.
Yeah, it's such a good play here. Froggen gets caught. Meteos sees it. Flash knock up there. And then they all go up except for Hard. And Hard's like, oh god!
Yeah.
I mean, that's his own gravity field. He could have maybe flashed back up and then explosive cast people away from him. He would have been on the grounded effect afterwards, not before. So he did have the opportunity to do so.
The dominoes start to fall. for Fox. Cloud9 now trying to pick up the Baron. It doesn't look like they'll meet too much resistance.
Well, Hart is on the bottom side. He's over at the Ocean Drake.
Okay.
Gonna go for a pick smoothie.
A lot of resistance, actually. The ultimate from KFO was spot on with the Baron damage. Smoothie makes it out by the skin of his teeth, and it looks like they may actually be able to walk out of this one. Impact is going to take days to take down if they really chase him in this fight, and he should be able to walk out quite easily.
Yeah, they're looking for the turret damage right now. The Baron buff goes over to Cloud9. They continue to deal damage to that Baron, and now it's Get Ocean Drake for Fox. They think they're going to have enough time here to actually get to it and take it down before Cloud9 meet them. Cloud9, they have multiple options. They can fight him here, they can go down mid, but it looks like it might be the fight.
There's a ping just behind them that says go blue. Fox was pinging right into that area, so everybody knows which way to disengage, make their way back to the base, and get to mid.
Yeah, they have to go up and around though, so This mid turret unfortunately doesn't have a wave for Cloud9, so they have to clear it out. And even though they take the long wave, Fox are able to defend their turret for just a little bit longer. But is Baron buffed up minions?
Then you can see inventory sometimes show intent as well. Four pink wards ready to be moved up by Cloud9. They're ready to defend those as well as they move up. Cloud9 are feeling good.
They're feeling really good here, especially since TL ended up losing their match today. Cloud9 could really just make TL not in contention for that third place spot.
Scary, scary thing when you're sometimes not in control. Cloud9 is the one that really has everything that they can do in their hands. Right now, looking good for a game one win in this match against Echo Fox, as they have spread what was an 800 gold lead now to 5,000 in their favor.
Yeah, and this was really close to being, in terms of scoreline, like a 5-3. Like, Impact has saved people multiple times. Smoothie almost went down. Didn't even get Stan United that time, too. Very, very close to being a 5-3 in kills. And also Fox, they kind of squandered their lead. When they had that turret advantage, they swapped and got damage on the tier 2 bottom, which they've never been able to revisit.
You see even KFO. Ooh.
Still not enough damage to actually clear out the caster
exactly.
Just yet. They have to ulti with Victor.
It makes it so tough, expecting this team to have incredible wave clear, and it's just not coming through. A few tags onto Keith. Sneaky Immedio is hitting the correct target immediately, and it rushes out the rest of Fox. They have to disengage without really the DPS there. It's going to be hard. KFO's not putting out too much. Froggen is the last line of defense here, and they're trying to scramble to keep those two guys alive with Big and Hard.
I feel like they hold on to so many things, like KFO's ultimate, Froggen's heal,
yeah.
Big's exhaust. There's a lot of tools here that you're able to use early on in these fights, maybe even save your team member.
Got to be a point where you pull the trigger. Even if everybody's not on the same page, he's still got to go with that call. 6-0 here. The turrets have fallen, but Cloud9 has managed to stay on their feet the entire game, taking down the first inhibitor now and not looking to fall anytime soon.
Yeah, and after getting that Baron, that Ocean Drake call from Hard, and Froggen showing up there, pretty easy for them to make the call for that. And that gets them this. Taking a lot of damage there. Keith just gets blown up.
Yep.
Jensen off on the side too, so yeah. Hard also blew the explosive cask, but it wasn't as effective as he would have wanted it to be. It just seems like these fights are just not going Fox's way. And if they're playing for team fights when they have so many opportunities in the early game to actually get these advantages and keep those advantages, the team fights aren't in your favor. It's like, what are you playing for? At that point, you're not playing to win. You're playing to not lose.
Yeah. Waiting for super minions now to push into the top side. Cloud9 taking their time.
Right now, go. Body slam, flash.
There is
you
two in the
bot.
It could be a big journey that comes through here from Smoothie, but they decide to disengage right away. Fox still realizes that losing a fight out here could be worse than losing one back where you can defend under a turret.
But they have to allocate the right people to the right places. They send both KFO and Froggen towards the bot side, and now this mid turret takes a lot of damage because Froggen's not there to actually wave clear. Did it? Show it. Ah. Oh.
Whoa! The Cutlass as well. KFO has not been respecting the damage surrounding him throughout the game. And at this point, standing way too close to things, they just can completely take him down.
KFO's so squishy, and it's this Gangplank just being so far behind. I mean, he would have been like maybe one more level, but it's still being blown up. Squishy build, not able to actually put pressure on this Ezreal from Sneaky that's three levels up himself and has been getting a lot of that sideways farm. Talking about they put him in a side wave every time.
Always. There were pings on the side wave when they were actually taking that top inhibitor. It was crazy. Cloud9 knows what they need to do next. The curtain call comes down. Keith trying to stand his ground in the backside and the inhibitor turret onto Impact. The best person here for Cloud9. Everybody's taking the journey and the tether doesn't even lock. Meteos down. Could Smoothie be the first to fall? They still make it out alive. And Hard is going to go just that for Jensen. He gets on. Jensen throws down the Miasma Slow. And nobody can get to him. They turn around to try and fight this as Meteos goes back in as well. And they can't decide if they want to stop the fight or not. And Fox is in the same position.
Froggen really bold right now. Impact still doesn't take too much damage from him, but he'll get enough rotations off with the Rylai's. Gets him over the wall with the Shatter Dash.
Ridiculous. If it would have been him for the first guy to go down, that would have been even crazier. But here's this already. Cutlass at the end as well, locking the kill. Ooh. Actually, didn't even get the parlay off. That hurts.
Yeah, no crits in there or anything like that. That's just straight up. Full damage right in the face.
7-0, 3-0-2 as Impact had just that in the early game. Absolutely ridiculous. Calling Hard up, which actually made the bot lane easier for Sneaky and Smoothie. Then the top lane was kind of given up, which gave it to Impact because they kind of left KFO on an island and tried to help out Keith and Big. And again, Froggen was just left to farm against Jensen in the mid lane, decide whether to rotate. And they didn't really work a lane on the side of Fox.
I definitely think that Impact is a lot of the catalyst for why everything happened the way it did.
Yeah.
Because he created his own advantage. He got that flash very early on from KFO, and then it just made him pretty much unduelable from that point forward after Meteos had the return game.
Heard a little bit of these guys coming in. No reason to ever play a lax game. Gotta stay strong, gotta stay focused. It looks like they're doing that right here. It'd be pretty impressive if they can get through this without dying at all with the amount of DPS that you'd see from a Gragas, a Gangplank, a Victor, a Jhin, and nobody on your team falls means you were doing something real right the entire time. Avoiding all the dangerous spots and actually causing Fox to really march the beat of C9's drum, fighting in all of C9's choke points, and C9 disengages until they get that fight that they want. They've done it every time this game.
And Fox have had to rethink their whole approach to League of Legends during this game because the Shen ultimate, every time you want to gank bottom, it's a big problem.
Right.
Then C9 actually went to the source of their global at the start of the game instead of to the side lanes, and it's something that you don't always expect, but Impact was able to just carve out his own advantage, like we said. And now, more gold! Just gave him 20 gold.
Oh, man.
He's a monster.
It's one of those things that feels really satisfying, but it's ultimately incredibly frustrating.
That turret
for
tickles
that.
It.
Yeah, it's not doing too much right now. Level 17, he is just about the highest in the game.
Oh my god, he's going to try to kill him under the turret.
He's going to solo him under the turret. There's the orange. He gets out. And he definitely has to use the Shadow Dash to get himself to safety.
Oh, here goes Frog.
Minus that, the minion wave comes in. He's the first death. Impact goes a bit too hard. The team's going to get something big out of this, I think. They could really play this one in not the right way. Fox is taking advantage of two now being down in Cloud 9. Get a little scatterbrain for a second.
Yeah, and Fox end up getting those two kills, and now they get pressure off of them. Impact was trying to create enough pressure to actually prevent the stopping of Baron. Froggen came up, so his plan was pretty much perfect, but the execution is usually not requiring you to take 80% of your HP and turret damage. So, bit of a mistake there from Impact. He won't be up for 20 seconds. This Baron can take some good damage. They have more DPS than Impact has Death Timer to get back up, so.
50-50 is there.
Oh.
Level 15 to 14, Meteos' Smite is going to be stronger, but they pull off a Baron. Gravity Field gets Meteos. Jensen's popped in! And that's the 5v5. Fox was looking to group, get the displacement in their fight.
In the back.
Teleport coming in. That's the stand united onto Sneaky. Froggen's going to get hit. His shield comes out from the Q. He stays alive. Impact looking for one last attack. It is going to be Fox's Baron, and Froggen keeps himself alive with the Flash as well. Looking for more speed from the minions. He's just trying to buy time and delay Impact from getting back, delay Seed 9 from getting more, and Fox has some defense in the base now.
Oh, man. They don't have a top inhibitor turret, though. So C9, despite not having the Baron, they can barrel down this top lane, and it'll be a 3-on-4. Trying to muscle down this inhibitor and get themselves a little bit of respite here.
Take a little bit longer to take down these super minions, or rather, Baron minions, I should say. But it's not that much defense. I made it sound like it was going to be grand for Fox. They're really just cleared out with the power that Cloud9's bringing already. A curtain call immediately to stop that from going down, and we'll see this Baron once again.
It was almost a 10,000 gold advantage for C9, and now it's about 6,000 after the fight. Jensen, ulti's KFO and hard, but it's Froggen and Keith that are really doing all the damage in this fight. And that barrel backwards right into their face. KFO gets the back of the pit, takes some damage big, gets blown up there by the Baron mostly. And then Froggen just sectioned off on the wrong side. Sneaky would have gone over the wall to kill him anyway. And Froggen, despite a little bit of a stutter step there by accident.
Sometimes you say worth, sometimes you relook at things and realize that Fox blew just about every flash to get out of that play. And you look at C9's side, and they're ready to flash even more on those bottom side of Jensen. Sneaky and Smoothie could be playmakers or saving a play as well. So Fox, they do have Baron, but they have to play even more careful now for the next few minutes.
Yeah, and this Elder Dragon comes up in a minute 15. And now they're going to try to push and get some advantage here, but you have to be careful. KFO, now the same level as Impact, so it's not going to be that big of a deal in the level department, and he's generating extra gold, so he's not actually behind at all. It's in terms of gold, Impact is actually behind KFO by 200 now. Game point things. Most of Span is sneaky in that jungle.
I mean, that's what you look for, right? Get that scaling, get your gangplank built up. It would be crazy to see a KFO come out strong in this. The mental that he had to endure in the early game to know that there's still an end to this. I can still get big. It possibly could be coming up. Tempered Fate locks down a good amount of members of the team. That's hard. As fast as that, it turns back around for Cloud9, but can they finish it off? As Fox tries to draw them back into choke points, the river's quite open in favor of C9 here possibly, but they are very low, and they do have to start to back off. One is down. Where can C9 move?
Yeah, they end up getting the jungler off of the field, though, for 30 seconds. Elder Dragon is up in 10, so the smite, no chance of that actually going over, but I don't think they're going to do it. It's so hard to do. Their health bars are low, and that gives Fox a little bit of time to shove in these minion waves.
These ocean drakes are great for Fox right now, too. If these fights go back and forth, as long as they don't keep losing one member, they can do this for a while.
Hart was the one that had Flash, too. He's the only member of the team that had Flash, and he's the one who got caught by Meteos.
Yeah, that's right. Got to be careful when those summoners are about to come up or not. Whoa, they Impact. Run up to Impact. That's a hit on the gravity field. Ooh. That's Keith down. The DPS from Jhin no longer in the fight. KFO is running towards the high ground with Froggen right now, and Meteos is going to give them a little bit of hell. The team is also chasing. Impact is cutting them off, but he's also going to meet up with Hard.
Well, Frog is just sitting in this bush. What is he doing? He's just going to try to go for like a hero play. It's Impact. He's so tanky.
He just taunts right through. He knows where they are. They put down the Farsight Trinket immediately for a perfect taunt. No engage coming from Fox as they are both looking at Impact. And he again comes up with a huge play on the forefront of these with Meteos, who is also not stopping as Smoothie blows Hard's flash. They're inside the base again.
It's absolutely crazy. Hard has explosive cast. You can run up towards your jungler who has a disengage tool, but they try to go for the hero play. They hope that Sneaky checks or something like that, but they don't get it, and that was desperation there from Fox.
Hard tries a great explosive cast.
Pours one out.
Entire party, that's all though. Pours one out for the homies as he goes down. And it looks like they're going for a few more points on the fantasy list as they take down the Nexus turrets. Cloud9 with a few mishaps towards the end of the game, but they right the ship once again and get themselves back into Fox's base just over 42 minutes. As they start to get on the Nexus, I don't think they're going to be stopping anytime soon. 16-3, Cloud9 takes game one over Echo Fox.
Echo Fox had opportunities, but they didn't take them. Early game advantage as well off of the turret, but Cloud9, Persevere, and Impact from the get-go, winning the matchup against KFO. pushing him in, getting his flash, and then just controlling the whole map.
It adds confidence to the rest of the team as well. Knowing that the top lane is doing well, you can take some more risks
when it's a possibility on the table.
Top definitely getting a hit this game. Irelia already off the board, so that means Fox has something in mind already. KFO wants to play something different. You're like, not that gangplank again. I'll carry a little harder with something else. Malzahar, Vlad also picked out. Expect the Anivia to come through. Maybe they'll let that go to Froggen. We will see. Ash and Sivir was the last ban, so that could be the Sivir Anivia here. Junglers, again, getting through.
Have to assume it's the Anivia. It's always banned against Froggen. Mm-hmm. You would leave Sivir on the table, which you would expect to be the first pick. Rek'Sai, possibly the Meteos, or if they really want Rek'Sai on their side. And yeah, there's the Sivir. So I assume it's a Rek'Sai first pick here for hard. I'm trying to think what else you would want to take. Anivia first pick in case they want to take it away, but...
I saw KFO laughing at first. They're maybe trolling this one a bit. You can pick Anivia at any point in time you want. Unless Jensen does, then that would be even more hilarious.
Yeah, that would be great. That would be so troll.
But I think you're right on the Rek'Sai here. KFO did really get an easy pickup for hard, and they locked that one in.
Yeah, don't allow Meteos to have it. I think that's really the big thing is you really don't want Meteos to walk away with that champion. The Irelia ban does open up Gnar as a very early pick for your top laner, and you may go for it, but the Shen is still on the table as well. So I assume you go for Jhin with Sivir and Ashe both off the table. And if you're going to take the Anivia, you do it now, but I don't think so. I think you go for support. I think you go Karma Jhin here.
Close.
Ah, all right.
Gnar Jhin with that Irelia ban, like you said, makes it a little more tempting. And Sneaky will get his 80 carry. Keith had that last time.
Yeah, the Jhin. The Gnar pickup very early on with the Irelia banned out makes a lot of sense, but yeah, that's assuming that Gnar has no more counters left in the top lane afterwards.
Gangplank.
Gangplank, actually, his barrels just kind of get auto-attacked down by Gnar.
Right. Just kidding.
Go play Shen into it, see what happens. Who knows? Try your luck.
Yeah. A little bit of global pressure already from that Rek'Sai, so... Looks like they actually want to focus KFO for more of a carry here. They may even let him round out the composition. Along with Froggen in that sense.
Yeah, I think it might be Karma Fiora here.
All right, so they take KFO's champion now. He has been huge on that Fiora at times.
Yeah, she's also gotten some slight buffs over time, seeing more and more power to her true damage. It's just barely, though. Itemization is also interesting for her. Black Cleaver, you know, since we last saw her, like Worlds and stuff like that, it's really just... push down in terms of how cheap Black Cleaver is. It's pretty early on.
Going wild in the EU LCS too.
Yeah.
Recent, as of last week.
It's quite aggressive. Mm-hmm.
Definitely a KFO champion. Cloud9 always likes to wait for a certain time. They lock in together, not giving the other time much room to think, room to get an idea in. So that'll probably be like a 10-second lock-in or less. We'll have both champions on that side. Already looking at the Jhin, at the Gnar. They swap it over, and it looks like it's going to be a Gragas Braum.
Makes a lot of sense here. Braum, alongside the Jhin, is actually a very powerful.
Ooh, all right.
All right.
I like that.
I love it.
Let's take it.
Last week, we had Smoothie playing Thresh, and even Bunny Fufu tweeted out, you know, that's really me on stage.
I swear it's me.
Yeah, he actually played a really mean Thresh, and of course he was a Thresh main. I think I've said this like maybe three times now. Final time I'll say it. There's this era of Thresh main challenger players that all started making it in. Sheep, Maria,
yep.
Remy. We had Smoothie, Bunny Fufu, all coming about. Sheep. Yeah, everybody kind of coming up at the same time, and he was one of them. So see what ends up happening. Sutsuro is also in there as well.
What do you want, Keith? What are you picking this game? Showed that love for Tristana already in the hover. It's going to be Froggen's Victor. Once again, we haven't seen too much of the Kalista pickup. You're not really going to want to throw a Karma into the fight. You can always pull her out for safety, but it is going to be that Lucian lock-in. Down past the ass. Down past the ash. Down past the sivir. No fines. They get the keep. They get the Lucian. Not going to be the Ezreal this time. Last pick up here for Cloud9. Jensen thinking, is the bird the word? Do they go the full troll?
That's the question. Is like, Anivia was finally left up for Froggen, and he's like, well, people are saying I wasn't playing enough Victor, so I'm going to play Victor. It's like, because Anivia was banned. But doesn't want to play it. The Gragas was already locked in. A lot of ways to catch him with a Thresh as well. And it seems like they were going to bait it, but there you go.
Nice. Get the Vel'Koz. Going to be disintegrating from the mid lane. And also scanning people down with that ultimate. So, completely different composition here from the side of Cloud9. What was a global Rek'Sai Shen comp in the first game switches up now. Pretty good fight comp. They can still initiate some good ones, but everybody has to be participating that time for C9. Fox, more damage to the top. Froggen still in a champion where they can get behind him and double down if they will. It's the strategy we're looking for Fox to use here. Still towards the end of the split, they can still round some things out.
Yeah, they need to get themselves together and prepare for the promotion tournament for Equifax.
Yeah.
In Cloud9, need to lock in that third place spot, so they cannot take Equifax lightly in the slightest. And just bringing out a couple more champions here.
Mm-hmm. The coaches will once again take leave, and the players are ready to get into game and get on the Rift. Make sure you head over to Twitter at LOLE Sports, hashtag FOXWin or hashtag C9Win for who you think is going to take this game. We got a bit of a switch up here from game one. As the analyst desk said, pretty methodical from Cloud9 in the first game with a few scattered mess ups. Fox, if they can get into those early, if they can get the lead, it seems like they can actually get behind Cloud9 strategy. They did push them out of the base a few times. Can they get it early, or will Cloud9 once again take an early lead for themselves? We're on the Rift, and we'll find out shortly.
And the early lead did go over to Fox last time, where they were able to get that turret. And if they're able to leverage that same type of advantage again, then it may just be something that works out perfectly for them. And KFO, you know, takes lunge level one. The changes to Fiora that actually hit in 614 were that her early true damage is up by five, and it's up at five. Or sorry, the health that she gets is up by five at all ranks. And then the lunge damage, but hold on, we'll talk about that in a second. Look at this catch.
Oh, the hooks! Hook, line, and sinker! Smoothie with the flash in to get the hook. The team benefits.
They just walk right into that, too. Both teams walk up. That's going to be the flash as well from Smoothie. Walk in, walk in. Hey, look at that. Hard body slam.
Ooh.
Flash hook from Smoothie. Not willing to risk it.
He's playing Darkstar as well, so very interesting. It kind of makes the end of the hook look a little different, but if you've played it enough, it's just like riding a bike. Smoothie comes up big for the team in the beginning and actually gets that kill for himself. Impact was the only one to miss out on that.
Yeah, and if you're playing against it and you aren't familiar with it, it's kind of like dodging a bike. And you've never dodged a bike before?
Nope, just riding them. Can't say I've dodged a bike. You prove a great point, Zyrene. The things we don't think about all the time.
Yeah, riding the bike, no, not too concerned with that in this game.
So the Thunder Lord's in for Jensen, as we would expect. Again, Froggen takes that. And we do get another matched up lane. We would have figured game one would have been a swap, but looks like Sneaky and Smoothie and Joy up against Keith and Big.
Yeah, they're not messing around either. Can play that Thresh. So this could be a kill lane, but I mean, he blew both summoner spells. He even blew his exhaust boot. So it is a bit of an advantage here for Equifax, especially since that kill, that first blood, did go over to Smoothie.
Take him a little bit longer to get those relic stacks without having Flay first as well. And hook number one.
Ahar actually has his smite left, so he'll get a burst of health if he does get the smite onto it. Froggen has to push in. Froggen has to try to get an advantage here.
That's what they're waiting for.
Medios is trying to get his smite back up. You're wasting too much time here, and he's just going to be in a great spot to actually fight you back.
Medios sees that it's hard is not following, so he wants to go back.
Yeah, here comes Impact.
You've done this so many times, you understand the amount of HP by looking at hard, how much he's going to lose. You have to be quicker about it.
Yeah, I feel like when it's at 800, you just fight it. You just go. You fight it.
Oh, gets himself up there.
I don't know why you throw the Q when you had Tremor Sense available to you.
And you know he's moving while he's attacking.
Yeah, he wasn't even like...
Wow. Persistence, though. Gotta give him that.
It's persistence, but he's falling behind.
Right, what are they gonna get out of it? If they can't get Jensen to come up, Froggen's continuously pushing that wave in, but...
So what he gets out of it is... He gets to know where Meteos is during the early game. So if he has an aggressive lane like in the bottom side and you want to make a play, or top is shoving in impact, like you can't do anything about it as a jungler. Well, he wrestles control from him and actually eventually gets down. Didn't he see the ward go down? I think he saw the ward go down.
He's going to step away from it though. Hop into the top side. So Gromp is going to be cleared by Meteos. They're actually free there. Jungle pressure, very odd to start this one off, considering it was that standard laning phase. Looks like Jensen will back to get himself another Doran's Ring really fast, actually, to make sure he can take the lasers from Froggen. A little bit of that upfront burst damage that Victor has. Seems like they're pinging the bottom side of the map as well. Cloud9 appears to think that Watch Out Hard may actually be on the bottom side. We're pushing up, but... Well, actually,
I think this is really cool because Hard is doing the Krugs now. That'll give him level 3. And Impact's lane is actually going to shove out. So it means there's going to be a lot of damage in it. It's a big wave. But if he does push it too far, he's an easy to gank Gnar. You just have to knock him up when he's jumping and get his flash out afterwards. Forward vital. He missed the forward vital.
He actually dashed to his right side as soon as it popped up. Of unfortunate timing there. And the minion wave to bounce off, just slightly missed.
You don't even have to go the full distance of the lunge. You can kind of do what he did there with a very short lunge, get it off a little bit faster, and it would have prioritized that. Lunge also helps you hit those vitals very early on.
Wears off, and he gives Impact a little distance. So Froggen playing the top side. Froggen's been hovering this as well, so it's not like he's being inconsistent with his movement, but you still gotta wonder if a mid laner feels that comfortable to farm Mirror Brush. There you got some support.
Yeah, and the fact that Hard showed himself top and he got nothing for it showed that he had the red and he was coming from that top side of the map, so Meteos assumes that the other red is still up.
Pretty much mirrored on both sides now. Mid laners know it. Jensen wards up to make sure that he doesn't get caught off guard by any flash trickery still. 46-39. Minions will easily be cleaned up here by Froggen as it comes in as well. Jensen still has that back already under his belt, so he has level 6. He could make something work here. Push Froggen out of lane with an ultimate. Could be quite easy.
Yeah, he actually got a free push, too. No upgrade from Froggen. And it looks like he's just kind of getting bullied right now. And might die!
Oh! I wasn't sure if it would be enough. I figured the ult would just push Froggen out of lane, but it almost puts him down.
How often do you play against a Vel'Koz
exactly.
Since his rework? And then he got changed a little bit too. So he ended up getting the full research on him and just started doing true damage with his ultimate.
Alright. Deconstruction. Like research, deconstruction? I can never remember. Got some technical term.
Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah. It's organic deconstruction stacks, and then when there's three, they become research.
Yep. Have all the information you need to do the damages. We'll see if Jensen can keep getting bigger on the spaghetti monster as it goes. 7 minutes coming up on this one. Mountain Drake's gonna be our first one. And level 6 is almost across the board here. Meteos waiting for his. Hard actually level 4, so C9 may be able to activate something off of a full team hit. Rather, KFO has the ult so he can put the grand challenge down. It doesn't look like he's even going to waste it. Knows he's going down. And just takes the hit from Impact.
Super good from Meteos as well. Because the Body Slam gives you too much time to react, and because the Body Slam Flash from a good distance gives you time as well, ends up just Body Slam Flash immediately. So basically starts the frames of the Body Slam.
Right.
He didn't have to flash, but it was the one that gave KFO the smallest window to react. Incredibly fast. It's the right way to do it. Doesn't take any risk with it too. Just boom. Look at that. You have no time to react as KFO. You have to predict it and take the guess. And even then, you want to do the riposte off of reaction.
Yep. Smart by KFO as well. Saved his flash. Did have to teleport back to lane. So he's going to be able to clean up a good amount of CS. Consider he'll be about another 5, 6 up, and then a few waves will be pouring into Impact. So they're pretty even in that top lane as they start to get to their damage items. Looking at the junglers here, Hard doesn't even seem like he's been back yet. Keeping himself as he just does. You see him on the map go for his smite. So he spent some time out in the jungle. Still below Meteos, though.
Yeah, it's a lot of time. In terms of gold, though, he's 250 down. Mm-hmm. So Meteos with those two assists has been doing a lot of work.
But he did a heck of a dance early game with Meteos.
That's true. It was a heck of a
dance. They got a workout in.
He kept them occupied, but Meteos still finds a way in. Meteos has the ultimate. KFO.
Can't get to that backside vital. Actually has to watch out for hyper damage and Magnar. This is a very interesting matchup. A lot of things to consider if you go in fight, and they usually keep fighting within their minion wave, so they can either jump out or dive out.
He got the counter stun, and he doesn't go for the grand challenge afterwards and try to beat up on
that
impact.
Was huge. Oh, Smoothie throws out the hook. That leaves you kind of vulnerable. But Keith also had to dodge out as well. So a little worse for the wear on the side here of Cloud9. They have to be careful. Big can just start throwing out those Qs and start harassing.
Once you get him under turret, it's really the ideal spot to go for the harassment because you're focusing on the waves.
Right.
But at the same
Nothing
time with
the
Thresh, it's so hard because he wants to hook you under turret.
Oh, that was the max range. The Flay just out of range. And the tether is going to be there. Big locks him down. The heal coming in as well. Keith has Flash to make a play if necessary. And it is going to be a slow walk from Froggen. We'll see if C9 actually stays. He heads back up. Called it. Pushed out a ward. And they said, no reason to come down, Frog, and you will be seen. Keep farming mid.
Yeah, Big actually played that really well. He ends up getting the Mantra W, so he gets the double part of the heal as well, because it heals you at the start, and then it also heals you the second tick when you have the full chain go off. And he got it off after the flash, so escapes, but they have to blow three summoner spells for one.
Ooh, nice inner flame.
It's actually, Keith!
What brush control? That's all it took for Smoothie there. Holds the Flay for a little extra time on Keith. Now forces his flash hard with a great pop on Meteos so he can't target. And they're forced to continue going for Big as they pushed him out of the fight.
Yeah, and KFO doesn't have TP. He had to blow it earlier after he got ganked. So C9 make a proactive play off of that. The hook from Smoothie really setting that up. He's been on fire so far.
What a better time as well, or it couldn't be a better time, I should say. Impact has a huge wave to clear after this, and we'll see the play again in the bot lane.
Yeah, and Keith, I mean, rule number one against a Thresh is really just be at hook distance away from him.
Yeah.
Just right outside. And when he has brush control, you can't be hanging out there at all. I thought it was the support at first. I thought that was Big in that brush. Supports are usually the ones fighting for brush control.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Smoothie's going to be kind of living in it.
Yeah, I think he wanted to bait for hard, but still, when you're at a TP disadvantage, you need to call that. And I feel like a lot of these games come down to they're not actually communicating within Fox on what's up and what's down in their lane opponent.
See if KFO can have that teleport back up soon, though. Or he will, I should say. But will they make that play now? Impax is down, a window they can work with. They're already going to start working the bottom side of the map here to get that dragon control. But if KFO actually is half health, he won't be able to teleport in much at all for these instances.
If Impact gets another round of his cooldowns, he has his Gnar available. He could kill KFO just flat out. But he doesn't want to take that risk. He's still actually respecting the power of the Fiora.
That's the question, though, on the other side. The flip side of does KFO respect his opponent this time? Two times we saw him going down, standing still in front of his opponent.
Yeah, I think he has to now. Impact got a kill, got an assist now, and he left lane, and he's now up in CS. So KFO is definitely having a very hard time in this lane and in this matchup because Impact has been playing what has usually been bad matchups rather well.
Something we see Impact doing, something we also see Huni doing as well. A lot of those guys can win their lane basically off of how they out-farm you, out-position, and then control it completely.
They also have really good and supportive junglers for their top lane pressure.
Exactly.
And look at this. KFO decides to go in now?
Ooh. That's not going to be good for KFO. He puts the grand challenge down, and they say, yes, I accept this challenge, but I also have a tag team partner. Meteos comes in there. They pick up another one. And as KFO tries to put himself on the board, it only becomes tougher in that top lane for himself. And it's got to be, you know, looked at for Cloud9. Two games in a row, they've able to come out of standard lanes. And Meteos has had that focus on Impact top because he controls that lane, and it's getting set up right for him to start off well.
And this is really good for Cloud9 moving into playoffs. If they can play to their top lane, there have been a lot of top laners in the North American LCS that have been performing incredibly well. And if you're able to actually have a good top jungle synergy, people are talking about how it's so mid lane focused, but now that those champions have started to get some nerfs, Azir, and now like Victor's early game, and even on top of it, right, like there's so many champions, Talia, right, that kind of been knocked down a bit, having this at your disposal, it seems like such a great strategy with things like Shen that are out of control.
Yep. A lot of people looking for just wave clear in that mid lane right now, so.
Yeah, and
Jensen having that.
6:15 is the lane swap patch, right? It's the one that kind of gets rid of it or makes it really risky. And first turret gold, if you can have this type of synergy, get that turret, boom, your top laner is fed. He's like 500 gold ahead of your enemy top laner, and you can just snowball.
Find the strength and the benefits of standard laning.
Yeah,
it's also, do it now and you're ahead of the game.
Exactly, and like it's what Meteos loved to do before, right? When he was with Balls and they had that great first season.
Yeah, that is true.
Camp top.
Just zap over the walls every time you can. A riposte for the last one. So he saves himself a bit of damage here. And what is the ring around the Rosie? Impact's a little short on that vision ward, but he says, I think up.
Made him use a pink.
As long as he doesn't show himself, he's good to go here.
He guesses right.
Oh!
Oh,
he's got the nose. It's been a while. This is the execute. Well done, but still, this Impact has had basically this lane to himself. 113, he's going to be able to push this one all the way in.
Heart is coming from the backside. This is a gank from the Rek'Sai.
Puts down the box, and that's Smoothie.
Oh my god,
he lives as he throws down the shield. And I don't know if they're going to be able to get out of this. Impact puts himself in the fray, but also has to get out. Meganar was just about to go off.
Yeah, and that would have been a great Gnar as well. He was on top of three people. He didn't have the backup, though, of Sneaky or Smoothie, because Smoothie just chunked out. And if he was able to get people low, the curtain call could have come through. Yeah, he actually has the Gnar available now.
What are they? They're getting hit. They're splashing the minions, which means the turret's going to hit them even earlier. And Impact comes in for an ultimate under the turret. They're
going
to be able to now wipe out a few members of Fox. The curtain call was an amazing idea.
This is ridiculous. Cloud9, game one and two, they just get by early game, skin of their teeth. This is another one of those games where it's zero kills for Fox, but it could have been three, it could have been four. Absolutely incredible. Cloud9 are playing these absolutely perfectly at the last second, and they're gonna get another turret off of that. This looks ridiculous. I thought he was gonna transform. Look at his Gnar bar. He's got nothing in there. And then he throws it back. And by the time the animation is done, he's mini Gnar. It's absolutely well-timed. He was backing right before that, thought the play wasn't gonna happen. He had flash, he had leap, and he uses both to get there, and just barely.
Those plays only happen when you are literally reading the mind of your opponent, saying they're gonna come in, mixed up in the minion wave, and that's the condition where this works, and that's what happened.
It's like half a literally a fraction of a second later, and that play just makes Impact look dumb. Because he turns into mini Gnar.
But it worked out, so he looks good.
Yeah, it's brilliant.
He has been having that game that gives him the confidence, the Shen in the first game, now piling over, rolling over to the Gnar in this game. 3-0-2, looking to even possibly get a second player of the game here. Sneaky, a little dark passage to the light as he gets saved. And Fox is really, you can see him trying to bite down, like, we need to get something here. Need to get something here. They are being relentless.
You do that at the start of the game, and you need to use hard to do that.
Yeah.
And once again, top side of the map now. 0-6 for Fox. Their only deaths are this top side of the map in the jungle. They tried to focus bottom. Oh, sorry. There's that one death as well for Big. My math was 0-6, but one of them's an execute.
Like, what happened?
Yeah. It's like, but still, they're damage dealers.
Yep.
They're mid lane and an AD carry. Kind of untouched for now, but Meteos is really going to focus this side now because Impact, he's just going to take care of business.
That would have been a pretty good stop. It really would have caused Hard some trouble. Probably could have sustained it back up for a few more cams, but now he gets to stay out for even longer.
He's going to go get the blue, too. Yeah. Like, Impact is just going to be as annoying as possible. We saw him try to dive an inhibitor turret last game. Took 80% of his HP.
Yeah, so he came to be the first death after things. Got a little ahead of himself.
Got another blue.
Caulfield's after the Frozen now, doing even more damage to KFO, who's on a Tiamat and Lucidity Boots, so he's already got goal side on him. Grand Challenge is issued.
Uh-oh. He's got to hug the wall. Oh, he finally got it.
Gets the heal. I don't know if it's going to be too much longer. He knows he needs to jump out. It's taken a little too long in his warding in the river. Gives him that idea that he needs to get to safety. Easy to say for me. And we're coming up on 20 minutes here. And everything so far has been Cloud9 on the forefront, writing what's going to happen next. Fox acting reactively, which makes it even tougher.
And Cloud9 are doing kind of an oldie but a goodie here, where you get your top laner ahead, you play to him, and then you stop playing to him completely. And this is a skill that top laners need to acquire, and so do junglers on teams, because you get your top laner ahead, he hits critical mass, and you say, okay, where is that? Where he is the person I'm putting all my resources in, and then you stop putting things into him because he's just so far ahead already that he's creating his own advantages like this, where he pulls two people up. You can make a play on the other side of the map with a numbers advantage 100% of the time. And C9 are doing that immaculately.
Yeah. And we see that it's not just blowing the flash in the top lane.
Yes.
You keep coming back.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the thing. Keep coming back. Get him like one or two kills, maybe even three. Maybe that's the sweet spot right there. Mm-hmm. And then you go elsewhere. And then you start just wreaking havoc on the map.
Yeah. Then you expect Impact to come down and help Sneaky get two kills, as it has happened as they start these teleport plays being in the lead. Mm-hmm. No Rift Herald coming through. This game has just been too much scatter, and the standard lanes have really put a lot of action in the bot lane here, and just some solos towards the top. Now back to the mid. We did see Fox previously in game one able to drop the outer turrets a lot faster. This time without that gold, they seem to be having a much harder time. Cloud9's really able to just shut them down. Every entry, all the wards. Already that Ruby Sightstone once again for Smoothie. We'll see if Meteos even goes that route again.
Oh, it's a flash out of him too, because this is a hook that he's comfortable with.
Just on the edge. Also waiting for the riposte. Nice job for the hooks. Cloud9 now able to just get Fox to disengage from a few across the map shots. And that means it's going to be very hard to guard turrets.
Ooh. Big. Oh, whoa.
One side of the map to the next. This team has so much range to put people in their position. Bring them right back to where they want.
That looked crazy.
He got popped, had the hook on him already, he got dragged back by the hook and a flay.
That was like a wanted hook. That thing, like, curved around.
Hey, when you're good, you're good. Ooh, he catches him on the slow.
Oh, and sometimes you're just not.
Into the wall as well.
Oh.
Gets the Dustbringer on him.
It's so much damage as well. Already has the multiple physical penetration items here. And yeah, this, look, three people are trying to kill Impact, and he's gonna be fine. You have the flash knock up him, right, and he's in range.
Yeah.
He's fine.
Nothing.
Now you get mid-tier too.
And the Rylai's not even close for Froggen in that build, which would have facilitated that.
Ugh, it's too little too late. That's the big thing.
They're chasing a bit too much as well. Like you said, too little too late. And now they're going to be too late to this mid lane turret. Not enough minions just yet. So really, C9 nicely prepping the second tier of outer turrets here to go down shortly. The mid one should fall, and bot wave is mounting. Pretty good minions.
Yeah, you push this wave up, you have Jensen clear this next one, you rotate to the bottom side, get wards in this whole jungle, clear out their pinks, or clear out their pinks.
Sharing is caring.
And now you can actually do multiple things here. Impact and charge an R-bar for a
play. Whoa! They go right up in Sneaky's face. The curtains call toe-to-toe with Keith and Big, and I think that's exactly what they wanted. Said, go out of position if you think I'm going to be that careless. The team is ready to back me up. Smoothie gets himself in a scary spot, but C9 is still there, and they realize the power of the full five in the bot lane.
And now they're just going to zerg this down, get some damage on it with Sneaky.
Good gravity field. Froggen can't really get into range to do too much clearing and instantly taken down. Smoothie keeps hard in place with the hook and a belly slam from Meteos. And they are now in on the inhibitor turrets. The inhibitor's next, and KFO is even turning his back too. They can't fight this right away. He tries to put damage on Meteos, hit up a wallop and a knock from Impact. KFO forced back to the Nexus and gets taken down by the autos of Jensen and Impact.
A Smoothie!
Very close, he gets taken down. They gotta be careful. This is what happened last time. They got themselves way too scattered as they go for a fight. There's no priority target as they're going in. Everybody thinks they can take one down, and that's where Fox tries to capitalize. However, Cloud9 again gets multiple people out by the skin of their teeth.
Yeah, and right there, Sneaky just barely, oh wait.
Oh, walk back into it. Button for punishment.
And they just can't pick up these kills. It's just so close to actually having an ace there in favor of Echo Fox, but Cloud9 just barely yet. Hard gets hit up. Oof. Completely destroyed. Impact goes in, and this looks like Froggen is just running so far back, and then he avoids the body slam. And I'm unsure of what exactly it is, but Froggen has to like run away from this fight all the way to the top side. Actually goes near the turret too. And I feel as though they may not be communicating flash timers exactly, because that looked like he was body slam flash range away.
Yeah.
As well as like flash gnar range. So, unsure. Ooh. Keith, you know.
Keith, you're in at this point. You're going for it.
Yeah. It's one of those things where like, if he had the black cleaver and boots by that time,
you're right.
Maybe he could have like turned into, I guess, Rick Fox status from Korea. And 1v3, but didn't have the gold. Just two levels down on the enemy AD carry, and Sneaky once again bubbled resources.
Yeah, it's getting very difficult here. 10,000 gold down when your complete core items down as well. There's almost no way you can match up in these fights. Cloud9 knows that. They use this strength to go ahead and take their Infernal Drake. I'm sure the rest of the Drakes are only on their menu as well. So much control over this game here. Game 2 much more organized from them. And I just say organized. Game 1 was organized. This is much faster as well. They're not giving Fox as much time.
Not at all. And that's what they need to do, because ultimately, Cloud9, they're gearing up for playoffs. You want to win the whole thing, especially
right.
Cloud9, because Cloud9 only got 10 points in terms of championship points. Impact is, looks like he's just buying, he's doing the Impact thing. He's like, I don't care if I die, I bought time!
And you bought an ultimate as well from Victor, his flash. It could hurt them in the next fight. C9 on the doorstep, a nice move by Keith. Very fast fingers to get out of that for Meteos. That's been literally the engage that's taken down hard and the rest of the team. This time they buy a little bit more for themselves. The inhibitors stand. It looks like they're gonna try another defense.
Yep, clear out the jungle on the way back, make sure there's nothing there for Echo Fox to take. And Cloud9, like I said, they're gearing up for playoffs. You want to win. You want to get as high as possible, too. And third place means a lot. If they get third place in the regular season, not only do you play one of the teams like Apex or Envy, the two that are still in contention for that last spot, you skip TSM in seeding because you will play Immortals if you move on to the next round.
Yep.
So it's incredibly important to be that third seed versus the fourth. Cloud9 want to drop no games. And they only have 10 championship points.
And so it's scary to think that those are like the best options as well, because it's still TSM and Immortals. And you're like,
yeah.
Well, I'm going to face them anyways. I just hope not as early.
Exactly. And Immortals, though, you know, they did lose the TSM. They dropped the game to P1 just
right
now as well.
Mm-hmm. You're pretty crazy. A lot of things can still happen here. A few teams to be switched around within these last games. And like I said, Cloud9, it is in their hands. Push themselves forward into that playoff position. Be seated exactly where they want. Black Cleaver's now finished. We were just talking about that for Keith, but he's still so far behind.
Yeah, he also went for a triple armor penetration item here. It's a little bit awkward, but we'll see. He's going for the Maw.
Looking for the outplay here.
Oh,
the
wall,
and he's able to get it as well.
That was
with
a
the
godlike
activation.
Play.
He's been waiting for it. Whew. He knew he could do it the whole time, and we've been guessing it. Yeah. He hasn't.
Well, you can. Fiora is actually really good in this matchup when you're able to get in on him, and I thought that was going to happen way earlier. I was waiting for that grand challenge during the laning phase, and he just got ganked over and over again and didn't respect it. That was insane, though. Flashes to the other side of the wall because that's where the vital is, and he gets it while Impact is in the air because you know he's going to try to escape that route.
Gets it, activates as well on the passive attack.
Yeah.
Oof. Or I should say the active, not passive. So well played.
Hits the bottom.
Impact
afterwards.
As well, trying to deny vision in this fight.
Boom, boom. Got him as well. Yeah, so that was pretty insane. Also, another thing to like add on top of that is that the riposte does slow your attack speed by 50%. And it always feels really awkward when you get hit by the W that your next auto attack, sometimes you cancel it, but there's just a big delay in it there, which made all the difference. If he had missed that riposte, it's a very different story.
A lot of the things you don't consider as well when you're going in that fight, it's not one of the things you remember right away. Like old Gragas barrels used to slow your attack speed as well, right? It's kind of almost a hidden thing, but it's there.
Yeah, attack speeds are like, Anivia's R used to do it too.
It's quite an annoying thing as well. It's something you're really not expecting.
You feel it though. You definitely feel it.
Absolutely feel it. Because usually you have about 40 seconds to think about it when you're dead on the fountain. 30 minutes coming up on this. 12 to 4 here. Cloud9 trying to end this one a little bit faster. And you can see the Elixir of Wrath on KFO as he tries to put even more economy into solidifying these fights because there may only be a few more left.
Exactly.
He's trying to get maximum power. Cloud9 initiating one of those fights. Big knock back. Flashed over the wall. They did give him an out there.
Nice heal.
Good dodge. Looks like they're going to be able to get out of this one. And quite a bit used here by C9. And KFO still has that push. He relieved so much pressure when he took down Impact.
Yeah. And he still has the ability to actually kill Impact again if he plays it right. He just has to get a few vitals first. Ooh.
Teleports are up for both of these players. That's the challenge.
He's not even hitting those vitals. Missing them just barely.
Rushing through as well. It's got to respect the Mega Gnar bar. Doesn't want to go onto the inhibitor turret. Cloud9 was actually just positioning around Baron as well. That's pushed back into their side of the jungle mostly. You can see Fox lining up as well. They actually look like they're jockeying for a fight. Gravity Field gets the hook in. Froggen's safe in that sense.
Smoothie,
a few more shots, but the culling is stopped short.
Yeah.
As Keith is forced out of that position.
And gets the heal as well on top of it and has to use the locket. So Smoothie just barely getting out again. You haven't used some summoner spells there. Sneaky with his back.
So KFO getting a little more control on the side lane here. This is what he was hoping to have with that Gangplank in the first game.
I feel like KFO is also a little bit nervous right now. I feel like he has some nerves. Because the way he's not hitting these vitals during the Grand Challenge is really indicative of somebody who's like a little bit jittery or like maybe having some doubts because those are pretty easy to hit, especially since the Q will prioritize them.
Right.
And then he's just right up inside of Impact.
What's the trade? Inhibitor for Baron? It could be a possibility. Fox would love to break the base if they can get out of this relatively unscathed. And it's going to be Impact being able to get goal side of that inhibitor turret. So Cloud9 holds Baron. KFO not looking good here. He will not be able to get enough health back to survive this fight. And Impact throws him up against the wall and wins that one completely.
Yep, and immediately KFO is like,
I'm
a bike, USS. Get out of these stuns.
Yeah.
That doesn't blow it really early on either. Gets taken out, and that's exactly what Impact wanted.
There is a difference that, as well as the Banshee's Veil, could have absolutely helped there. We'll have to see in the next fight when these two tango. Impact is back in now. Remember, KFO is down. This is a 5v4, and Fox is getting wiped as they were outside of their base. Numbers down, and Cloud9 takes advantage.
That was a beautiful cast there from Meteos. Body slam, then the flash to get distance, and then it hits Froggen off to the side, primary damage dealer of Echo Fox, who's 3-1, mind you, still with a very good record, and I would assume is dealing a ton of damage in this game, but he's just not able to pull it off, not able to dodge it, had to use his flash earlier. And then the follow-up of the Deadly Flourish is actually on point, too. That's great. Forces the flash out of Froggen. hits him off to the side. Deadly Flourish follow up there. Because Sneaky could have gone for that last curtain call shot.
But he slows the team.
Onto Hard.
Right.
It may have killed Hard, but he's like right on the edge. Maybe I hit him, maybe I don't. And then he just goes for Froggen instead. And that gives the slow for the flash.
Really synergizing well. This Jhin pick has been at the top of compositions for Cloud9, as well as Cloud9 being able to fight without Sneaky recently in his side lane adventures that he's been going off to, almost Doublelift-esque from Doublelift's past. But with the range of the Ashe, what they've been playing, these Ezreals, the Jhin, they can activate those alts and actually still facilitate the engage for the four members. Once again, this fight back and forth.
Oh, he's got to get in there now.
There's that attack speed slow. Onto impact. He gnars out. And there is the cleanse for the Quicksilver Sash. Pretty good fight, but Impact knows it is a losing battle as it goes now.
Yeah, he actually...
he doesn't have a big wall to slam KFO against.
Yeah, and KFO still has the QSS to get out of that.
Yep.
That's good. And in hit, they just force it down. Oof. KFO has TP advantage as well, and they're still not forcing it out. Impact was topside, and maybe you could have made a play there. But the engage is pretty hard to pull off with Echo Fox, especially against something like a Thresh, a Vel'Koz, and a Gragas.
Yeah.
It actually feels miserable to be a Rek'Sai against a composition like this. Because when you reach that mid part of the game, the late game part, like I need my flash to do anything in these fights that resembles engaging. Yeah.
You really could just get flayed out by Smoothie on your way in. So many little things.
You're going to get flayed. You're going to get body slammed. You're going to get cast.
Yeah.
I mean, hell, you're even going to have a huge tell on where you're coming out of the tunnel for the Vel'Koz to hit you.
That's true. He can pop you up immediately and lock you down in that spot for the rest of the team. Moving down, the finishing touches on the outside of Fox's map. The curtain call starts this one off, and there's so much pressure around the turret. Getting locked down. Big's not going to be able to help for the rest of this fight. He'll be calling shots from the fountain for the team. Froggen as well now gets the overhead view as Cloud9 starts to take down the last inhibitor in the base. KFO teleported in, but now he's being forced out of his own base. And Cloud9 a bit faster this game. Faster than game one, that is.
Oh, he wants the duel. 18-4.
He'll get his duel. The grand challenge is accepted. How far can it go, though? And it stops with Sneaky. They're on the last Nexus turret, and it's going to be the Nexus in the eyes of Cloud9. A necessary 2-0. They get it, and Cloud9 takes the match over Echo Fox.
And Cloud9 in striking distance of third place, and having a much better seed in playoffs. With Team Liquid faltering today, and Cloud9 just looking on the